Hi, and welcome to the World Beyond Belief. My name is Paul Markle, and we're privileged again today to have Eric Karlstrom visiting us. He has uncovered some incredible information on 911 that I consider to be the capstone. This puts everything in perspective and names names and demonstrates exactly how this was done. So if you're interested in this, and we all should be interested in this, because this is the whole impetus for the war on terror. This is the reason that we have the Patriot Act. This is the event that triggered everything, and it was a false flag. And Eric's going to talk about that. Good morning, Eric. Welcome to the World Beyond Belief.
Good morning, Paul, and thanks so much for giving me a chance to talk about this latest kind of discoveries on my part. Which, as you say, I think kind of ties things together in a number of ways. Now, let me just introduce myself for the benefit of your listeners. I taught geography, physical geography, at three universities for 30 years. So, you know, I was professor of geography, most recently at California State University, Stanislaus in Central Valley, California. And as a physical geographer, of course, I was very, you know, on the earth science side of things. So I knew, based on my own research in past climates, which was really the focus of my PhD and master's degree, as well as my subsequent research, I knew, you know, pretty much from the get-go that the global warming fraud, was a hoax, that the humans have had very little impact on weather or climate by burning fossil fuels, driving our cars, etc. However, I soon discovered later that the real story behind the story of the global warming hoax is the military use of geoengineering, weather warfare, and weather modification. When 911 happened, having gone through the Vietnam era and being used to, you know, extraordinary government lying,
right,
it quickly occurred to me that this was also probably some kind of a hoax. And so I wrote an article in the fall of 911 entitled Reflections on the Origins of 911, Three Scenarios. And it's about a 60-page paper, and we had a little peace group in Crestone, Colorado, where I live, and one of the people in our peace group got a website put up, and they put it on the website, and pretty soon it was around. Mm-hmm. It was kind of the magic of the internet. So the bottom line is that I've got these two very, very, very large websites now. I've retired from teaching, and I've had more time to work on this. One of them is 911nwo.com, NWO, of course, standing for New World Order, and the other one being naturalclimatechange.us. So the first one exposes the 911 hoax, fraud, inside job, false flag, state-sponsored synthetic terror event.
Uh-huh.
And the second one exposes the fraudulent science, really, behind the man-caused global warming scenario, and also uncovers perhaps what the story behind the story is, which is that a lot of that funding has gone into geoengineering research and actual operations. Geoengineering is the idea that, you know, humans can redesign the climate system and cause earthquakes, move storm fronts, create floods and create droughts, move hurricanes, juice them up, knock them down, even create tornadoes. And again, there's a lot of information on this on my naturalclimatechange.us site. Now, so here we are in a world. I'm in America, you're in Ecuador.
Yeah.
We're still in the same world. You're from America, so you're
right,
totally conversant in all of these issues. But here we are in a country, in a world in which we're being lied to on a colossal scale, simply colossal. You know, it's like Joseph Goebbels of Nazi Germany said, you know, he was the minister of propaganda. He said, you know, a great nation needs great propaganda. And of course, Germany had fantastic propaganda during the Nazi era. And America has much better propaganda because we call it the news.
Right.
Russia, Soviet Union had good propaganda, but everybody knew it was, you know, coming
propaganda.
Out of one newspaper. So everybody knew it was lies.
Yeah.
In America, most people seem to be still, or a very large segment seem to be deceived. And so this, of course, is the point of my research. Thomas Jefferson said, you know, a nation that that wants to live in a state of ignorance, in a state of civilization, wants what never has been and never can be. So if you've got your people looking in all the wrong directions, it's pretty easy to slip some big things by them. And of course, this is what fascist totalitarian governments
right.
tend to do. So the basic thesis that I'd like to share with you tonight, or to this morning, we're this morning, is based on a couple DVDs and YouTubes that I recently watched, which just pulled things together for me. And those include Jason Berman's DVD called Invisible Empire, A New World Order Defined, which has a great interview with Peter Dale Scott of, he wrote a book about the JFK assassination and deep politics in the U.S. And then Webster Tarpley has an interview on Guns and Butter in which he discusses his book, 9-1-1 Synthetic Terrorism Made in the USA. He's gone now through five editions of that, and in each edition he has, by his own historical research, he's an economic historian, he's a real academic,
right.
As well as Peter Dale Scott. They're both PhD, you know, researchers, who I tend to, you know, kind of give a lot of credibility to.
Sure.
Webster Tarpley has a table on his website, and which I think he has it in his fifth edition of Synthetic Terrorism Made in the USA, of 46 drills and exercises and war games that were occurring either on or leading up to 9-1-1. And he's following newspaper accounts, and he's, you know, slowly but surely adding to the list. He had five for his first edition, four or five exercises or drills, as they call them. And then by the time he did his fifth edition, he's up to 46 plus. And I imagine there are quite a few more that haven't been divulged. But the picture you get then is of a government that heavily relies on, well, the military especially, that heavily relies on drills to plan out their operations. And I know you've done an excellent program on the Jade Helm drills of this year and the last year, which are very concerning. And the reason they're concerning is because although the military does drills as a matter of course, something can happen. Somebody high up can order that the drill become live,
right.
flipped live. And that happened on the London 7/7 bombings. That happened on 9-1-1 when these about 25 drills were going on the day. And they all of a sudden became a live, quote-unquote, terrorist event.
Right.
So you go from a drill in which individuals in the military think they are, you know, just drilling a scenario that could possibly happen, and they're trying to work out the details of their response
right.
to protect America. So then most of the people in the chain of command of the military would not be aware,
right.
perhaps while it's happening, that the drill has now been flipped live and a real terrorist event is occurring. So this is a very, very, very pernicious and clever way to control things from the very top. And Webster Tarpley, the historian, has written books on the, you know, the unauthorized biography of George H.W. Bush, the unauthorized biography of Obama. He's gotten into what Scott calls deep politics. And he says he calls the perpetrators of these false flag terrorist events, calls them the rogue network. They've mm-hmm. also been called the invisible government, the shadow government, etc. And sometimes now we even call them the continuity of government. In other words, the government, which is unconstitutional, which can and is prepared to take power in the case of a declared emergency by the president. He can use anything pretty much to declare emergency based on all these executive orders. And this would then impose martial law and a dictatorship and the tossing out of the American Constitution and the destruction of the American Republic as we know it. So I can give examples of some of these drills. Let me just refer your listeners to three of my most recent posts, which are on my 911nwo.com website. The first one is Appendix 28, Behind Operations 911, and quote-unquote Operation Crestone Baca, which is where I live, and we'll do a little tie-in there maybe later. Okay. And then the CFR CIA Nexus. We had an interview, excellent interview, about a week or two ago about Alan Dulles, the first director of the CIA, and he also was a founder of the CFR. So CIA basically does the bidding of the CFR, the Rockefellers, the Rothschilds, the elite, also the Wall Street Power Center, also in sometimes called, as Tarpley calls it, the rogue network or continuity of government. And also this got me into looking at the Doomsday Plan. There is a very interesting YouTube on now. You can just punch in the American Doomsday Plan, and it's all about the Air Force. Well, and that's the last part of the title, Appendix 28, and the U.S. Air Force, because it becomes very clear when you look at these 46 drills that NATO is involved in a very large percentage of them. That's the North American Air, what is it?
Well, it's got to have defense in there. Don't know what the O would be.
I've got that on my third article, which is summary of Tarpley's The 46 Drills, Operations, and War Games and Activities of 911. The second article is a transcription that I've just recently posted, a transcription of the 46 drills, operations, war games, and exercises of 911, which is this Webster Tarpley interview with Guns and Butter. Let's see here. So I actually did quite a bit of or a little bit of legwork on trying to figure out what all these alphabet soup acronyms are.
Right.
North American Aerospace Defense Command. That's NATO.
Okay.
And one of its main bunkers is in Cheyenne Mountain in Colorado, right outside Colorado Springs, probably about 80 miles as the crow flies from where I live in Crestone Baca, Colorado. And then other players, and this is the nice thing about Tarpley's table. You can go to Webster Tarpley's site. You can look at his table. There's a website for it there. I can give it to you. It's /tarpley.net/docs/drills_of_911PDF. And it's all in that table. And as I say, I'm looking now at an article that I just fixed up last couple of days on a summary of Tarpley's table here, which you get into the nitty-gritty. Well, the devil is the details, isn't it?
Mm-hmm. Absolutely.
These are all drills that in which the military was looking at scenarios, and all of them have a timeline. All of them have a certain number of participants, and they have certain goals that are enunciated. So you can look on this table and you really find out who's behind 911. And it's not encouraging. You have NORAD,
right.
You have NEADS, the Northeastern Air Defense Sector. You have SEADS, the Southeastern Air Defense Sector. You have STRATCOM, the U.S. Strategic Command, which is one of nine unifying combatant commands of the United States Department of Defense. Of course, Cheney was the Secretary of Defense at that time. You have AWACS, the Air Warning and Control System. You see the predominance of Air Force here.
Right.
You see the NRO, the National Reconnaissance Office. You see the Air Combat Command, the U.S. Space Command, the U.S. SOCOM, U.S. Special Operations Command, U.S. CENTCOM, U.S. Central Command,
right?
FEMA, Federal Emergency Management Agency, which we'll talk a little bit more about later, because
right.
you know, you're very familiar with that. USJFCOM, U.S. Joint Forces Command. Okay, Joint Forces, Army, Navy,
right.
Air Force, the whole works, Coast Guard. The DIA, Defense Intelligence Agency. There's one that's called LIWA. I didn't find that one on the Wikipedia. FBI, the New York Office of Emergency Management was involved in these drills that went live. The New York Police and Fire Departments were involved. The FAA, the Federal Aviation Administration, the Coast Guard, the Army, the Navy, the PTOG, the Proactive Preemptive Operations Group, the U.S. Department of Transportation, U.S. Air Force bases, Andrews Air Force Base, Nellis Air Force Base in Nevada, Offutt Air Force Base in Nebraska, Barksdale Air Force Base in Louisiana, Minot Air Force Base in North Dakota,
amazing.
Whatman Air Force Base in Missouri, and Wright-Patterson Air Force Base in Dayton, Ohio, and the Keflavik Air Force Base in Iceland, and the Dobbins Air Force Base in Georgia. All these were involved in the drills on the day or leading up to, and then the New York City, the government, you know, Giuliani's New York
right.
City was involved. There was a number of forts around Washington, D.C., Fort Belvoir, Fort Monmouth in New Jersey that were involved in this. The Miami-Dade County Police Department, the Westmoreland County, Pennsylvania, where Shanksville is located. Cheyenne Mountain, Colorado. NORAD plays a very important role, which we'll discuss. The Fiduciary Trust Company of the World Trade Center on the 97th floor on the South Tower, plus about 52 other unnamed agencies, are all involved based on Tarpley's research, which of course builds on other people's research and newspaper accounts of what the drills were. So again, drills are something that the military does, you know, to do its legitimate function
right.
of protecting America. But they, in a very, very hierarchical system, all of these chains of command can be subverted into taking the drills live or flipping them live.
Right.
And when that happens, of course, then the plan to defend against a terrorist attack can actually turn into a terrorist attack. And if you look at, I'm going to just outline the drills here, and I think you'll see, not one by one, but by groups, and I think that you will, and I'll give a couple examples, you will see that what they've done is they have drilled every single aspect and meme of the 911 terrorist attack scenario. So all of these things were very carefully prepared by military people and county people. First responders were brought in. The planning that went into this thing was phenomenal. And remember, Senator Bob Kerry said at one point, well, it was a 30-year plan.
Right.
Well, I think that's probably about right. It probably was a 30-year plan. So, you know, this, and this is a coup, according to Webster Tarpley. All of a sudden, the government is going down one railroad track, and it's jerked onto another set of tracks, and now it's going in a new direction.
Exactly.
And this is the event that catalyzed that takeover, really, by the Project for a New American Century neoconservatives who were running really essentially the Clinton, Bush 2, Obama administrations. But of course they are just one, you know, aspect of this. And just to go back in history, are there precedents for this? Well, we talked last time in our interview about Alan Dulles, about the 1934 coup attempt by Wall Street, in mm-hmm. which Alan Dulles's clients would have approached Brigadier General Smedley Butler in 1934 and asked him to lead a march of 500,000 troops on Washington to take over the Roosevelt government and turn it into a fascist government. So that was a pretty simple plan compared to this. This plan
right.
is amazing.
It's amazing.
I mean, you know, I used to think those intelligence guys weren't very smart, but now I see that those intelligence guys are very smart. And of course, they've got a lot of power. So Tarpley, like me, and in our discussion last time, really would put the focus of the conspiracy in Wall Street, the City of London, the intelligence agencies that serve them, including CIA and NSA and all the other alphabet soup, and Tel Aviv now, because that's really the triangle, Tel Aviv, London, and Washington. And Washington really is just, you know, Washington and New York, almost no difference now.
Right.
It's all one thing, yeah, because the New York Wall Street people seem to just dominate the Washington scene with all the lobbyists, et cetera. But okay, so we have about 12 drills which focused on the World Trade Center attack. And these were some of them before the day of, and some of them were on the day of. Let me just give you a couple of them here to give an example of these 12, and I'm sure there's more. Okay, NORAD, which we've already defined, and NEADS, the Northeast Air Defense Sector, as well as U.S. and Canada, on the day of 9/11, have live fly hijacking and air defense drill scenario with multiple hijacks, diversion, and confusion. Well, of course, that's exactly what happened.
Right.
Tremendous confusion, so much so that the air traffic controllers didn't know what was happening. Even the people reading the computer screen at the Northeast Air Defense Sector didn't know what was happening. And one reason is because the people over at Cheyenne Mountain were inserting false radar blips on their screen. And they would ask, well, what's real? And what's, you know, what's a drill? What's a false blip? What's
right.
a drill? What's real? So, you know, if we want to know why the, you know, the air defense system of the most powerful country in the world was completely silent for the 1 hour and 45 minutes of the attacks of 911.
Right.
It's here. The actual stand down order is recorded from the commander of the Northeast Air Defense Sector, and it's really, really kind of crazy. Back over to Operation 911. We hit that. We scroll down to Appendix 28 behind Operations 911. And then we go down to, you know, the quotes, the first thing. And, no, that's not the place. I'm sorry. It's, we should go not to that first of these three articles, but we should go to the second of these three articles, which is the transcription of Webster Tarpley's interview on Guns and Butter on the 46 drills, operations, and war games and exercises of 911. Okay, so here is the introductory clip, Webster Tarpley quoting this individual. The stand-down order that you have is a Colonel Marr, the commander of the Northeast Air Defense Sector. There is a request to him to launch all your planes, and he says, no, I won't do that, because if I launch all my planes now, they will all run out of gas at the same point.
Go figure.
How
does that?
And, you know, he gets away with saying this stuff because the 911 commission is completely, you know,
yeah,
in on it.
In a...
So I'm seeing them all on the runway, he said. This is the key to why for 1 hour and 45 minutes plus, there's no effective air defense in this highly critical and usually highly militarized area.
Right.
And when he does launch a couple of planes from Langley Air Force Base towards the end of the operation, he sends them out over the Atlantic Ocean. So this is Webster Tarpley's summary of that. You
right.
know, meanwhile, we are all told on the news that, you know, Cheney, you know, snapped his head around and he
right.
said, well, you know, that he was in charge. Well, Webster Tarpley makes fun of that notion because he thinks that actually who was in charge of coordinating all these things was a private military defense contracting agency, perhaps in Cheyenne Mountain, with at least a bank of 100, you know, computer, highly computerized screens to coordinate the operation.
Right.
So, we're always given the cover story, and
right.
then those of us who can't accept that then have to dig much deeper to
right.
find the real story, the story behind the story. So, I just thought it'd be worth to have the direct quote there from Colonel Marr at the Northeast Air Defense Sector, and also Tarpley's interview with with guns and butter. Okay,
right.
so to give another example of the WTC attacks, the World Trade Center drills, there were about 12 of them at least. I know more myself just from
Whoa.
Doing my research, but we'll stick with this. Well, yeah, I mean, in 1998, I believe he was a Saudi Arabian, planted a bomb at the World Trade Center, didn't he? And he
right.
and he did some damage and he killed some people. Well, you know, from testimony by him and others, we now know that the FBI was handling him.
Right.
And gave him the ingredients for the bomb and paid him to do it.
Mm-hmm.
So again, kind of contracting agent then from the Middle East to do the FBI's dirty work, in which they actually, you could say, rehearsed the blowing up of a building. I guess that's a little bit different from what I'm talking about. Yeah, it's the World Trade Center attack. Okay, so here's a National Reconnaissance Office drill in Chantilly, Virginia. 911 simulated plane crash into high-rise government building, as well as satellite imaging. Okay. Here's another one. Red X, that's the Operation Red X, recognition, evaluation, and decision-making exercise. Who's in on this? The New York City Office of Emergency Management, the Fire Department of New York City, the Police Department of New York City, the FEMA, FBI. And this was on May 11th, 2001. And the scenario was a plane crashed and a building collapses in New York City. Well, of course, that's World Trade Center attack and demolition.
Yeah.
So that gives you an idea of those, you know, that meme, if you will. Now they use that word meme. I kind of hate it. But the next meme or theme, I guess, is divert the fighter planes out of Washington, Boston, and New York, which is the airspace involved in the Northeastern Air Defense Sector's airspace. There's six drills going on there to get the real fighter pilots out of there.
Yeah.
So that, you know, these Air Force pilots are chosen, you know, kind of be the top guns, you know. So a lot of these guys would just instinctively go get the bad guy.
Right.
I mean, that's the whole training, and they've got the equipment to do it, and they're hot, you know. It's like
right.
all these great movies, you know. Well, how do you get those guys out of there so they don't screw up the plan?
Right.
Well, Operation Southern Watch, which was right up through 911. Diverts the 174th Fighter Wing of the New York Air National Guard to the Sultan Air Base in Saudi Arabia.
Amazing.
To impose a no-fly zone over southern Iraq. Operation Northern Watch, through 911, diverts six jet fighters from the Langley Air Force Base and sent them to Incirlik, in Iceland. Incirlik is in Turkey. There's Iceland comes in later. But Incirlik Air Force Base in Turkey to impose a no-fly zone over northern Iraq. And then there's a whole bunch of them that get them way up north. Operation Northern Guardian involves the Keflavik Air Force Base in Iceland through 911 and diverts again fighters from Langley Air Force Base, Virginia, to counter a Russian bomber drill. Okay, so there's all kinds of these. There's the Red Flag, Operation Red Flag, Nellis Air Force Base, Nevada. 100 pilots are involved, and it diverts most F-15s of the 71st Fighter Squadron, Langley Air Force Base, Virginia. But it gets them out of the way. I'm not sure. Also, the Flight Squadron of Andres Air Force Base is also depleted. The Andrews Air Force Base local drill 911 diverts three F-16s to North Carolina. So you get the picture. Get
right.
Get them out of there. And that's, of course, another reason why we
right.
had no air defense in that
right.
141 hour and 45 minutes. Okay, the next meme or theme is Pentagon attacks. And you have six drills there. There is a thing called the Pentagon Mascal, which is a kind of an operation I define at the top of this particular article or post here. And let's see if I can find it here. To do with killing people at the Pentagon. I mean, this stuff, you can't believe this stuff.
It's all coincidence. This is just a coincidence.
This is all coincidence. Yeah. There's zero chance of that. Absolutely zero. The NORAD drill 1999 to 2001, hijack aircraft, hit many targets, including the World Trade Center and the Pentagon, under Mescal. Amalgam Virgo 01, U.S. Canada, multi-agency drill, NORAD, SEEDS, Coast Guard, Army, Navy, June 1st, 2001. Unmanned aerial vehicle drone launched from a rogue freighter, in the Gulf of Mexico, or cruise missile from barge in Atlantic Ocean.
Right.
Is fired upon the Pentagon. Well, that's what happened. If you want to know what happened to the Pentagon, a missile hit it, or it might have been something like that, cruise missile, something like that. And of course, then they lied and said it was a, 757 or 767 or whatever. But this is the Joint Based Expeditionary Connectivity Center Mobile Radar Command Center was also tested. These guys are very, very, very thorough,
yeah.
Very high tech. The positive 401, the USJF, Joint Force Command, US Central Command, US Special Operations Command, and 40 agencies on April 17th, 26, 2001, are testing continuity of government. And they're testing attacks on transportation. As we're going to see in a minute, my hypothesis is that one of the main drills that was occurring on 911 that we haven't been told about was plans for continuity of government. Where there's only one day in American history where the plans for continuity of government has gone live. It has
right.
been tested. And that, of course, is September 11th. So we're going to see in a little while all the events that lead up to 911 as a drill for continuity of government, imposition of martial law. And one of the scenarios in positive 401 is a terrorist group hijacking a commercial airline and flying into the Pentagon. Well, there again, the Pentagon
yeah.
attack. Okay, next little group here is plane hijackings and simulated telephone calls. There are six drills that fulfill that scenario. One is by the FAA, Federal Aviation Agency, and the Miami-Dade County Police Department. A toxic chemical agent and the simulated release of radiation and radiological contamination, as well as indoctrination of first responders. So they use a word like indoctrination. So
right.
these first responders have to be fooled into thinking they're going to do some, heroic stuff, when
right.
in fact they're, part of a very well-planned
right.
Terrorist
deception.
Attack, false flag. U.S. Department of Transportation, August 31st, 2001. Their crisis management center drilled hijacks and simulated telephone calls. So all these, this was, as Tarpley says, this was to pull in the average American who doesn't want to look at the details here, but is emotionally impacted by, Mrs. Olson calling Mr. Olson and,
right.
Oh my God, she's going to die and that sort of thing.
Right.
And of course, these were all faked. They were done by actors on the ground, and then we hear those voices. So this is a very, very extensive operation.
Right.
Again, on that same theme, Vigilant Guardian, NORAD, SEEDS, NEEDS, September 10th, 2001. There's a hijacking of a plane from Cuba by asylum seekers, and it lands at the Dobbins Air Force Base in Georgia. Well, that's just more clutter, isn't it?
Mm-hmm.
Vigilant Guardian, NORAD, NEEDS, September 6th, Seoul to Anchorage flight hijacked by Lin Po to Seattle. These kinds of things, just to kind of muddy the water, make everything confusing. And then there's four drills to control the patsies. And, of course, Muhammad Atta and the 19 Saudis
right.
are the patsies. And one is Able Danger, the Defense Intelligence Agency, the U.S. SOCOM. Between December 1999 and 2001, they manipulate Al-Qaeda, which is... just a group of, it's basically a phone book full of operators in
right.
the Middle East that have money that the CIA has used as assets. But
oh.
now, of course, we're told different things. So it's a data mining program for control of patsies. And then the Stratus Ivy operation, the DIA, Defense Intelligence Agency, operates on patsies who are out of the box. So patsy control. Door Hop Galley, the DIA, again, December 1999 to 2001. This was mostly secret, but tarply thinks it's probably Patsy control. And then there's the proactive, preemptive operations group, P2OG. Kind of unknown, but the dates, but stimulation reactions of terrorists. Stimulating reactions of terrorists. In other words, handling them, controlling them. Now, this is the scary part that is quite a revelation.
This is the scary part.
This is scary. Yeah, we haven't got to
The rest part of it is normal. Yeah. Go ahead.
Well, according to Tarpley, the immediate geopolitical goal of this coup and this, you know, false flag terrorist operation was the U.S. wanted to invade Afghanistan and Pakistan. Afghanistan immediately and Pakistan kind of, you know, over the years.
Right.
And they were, you know, concerned, all these planners, these smart people, concerned that maybe Russia might object because we're moving into their...
Right, their sphere.
Their continent, their Eurasia. And, or China. And both of those have nuclear weapons. So how to disable that response? Well, Global Guardian, STRATCOM, the Offutt Air Force Base, Nebraska, Barksdale Air Force Base, all these Air Force bases, did a nuclear war fighting scenario called Armageddon. And they actually drilled and made moves like they were moving to attack Russia.
Wow.
And, of course, the Russians would be freaking out, saying, oh, my God, they're doing this, this, and this, and that's what they would do under an attack. And so, of course, that put the Russians on a, you know, state of high alert.
Right.
Amalgam Warrior 911 on the day, large live-fly air defense and air intercept, tracking and surveillance drill, air defense against foreign retaliation. Of course, that'd be the Russians. A Global Guardian computer networking attack, 911. Enemy forces are war-dialed. Now, this is really fascinating. The enemy forces are told, they're informed by war-dialing, through STRATCOM's telephone and fax systems, that there's a bad insider who has access to the C3 system, which is the missile launch option. So in other words, not only is America maybe going to attack, but they've got a real rogue element, a bad insider who might just do it. So obviously this is nuclear brinksmanship.
Right.
You know, not going to play with the lives of hundreds of millions, maybe billions of people, so we can get this thing pulled off. So that's the really scary part, if you ask me. That and the next, which is continuity of government, which includes installing new leaders in a successful coup.
Right.
There are three drills on that meme or theme. STRATCOM, Strategic Advisory Committee at all these Air Force bases, they put three E-4B National Airborne Operations Center planes, also known as the Doomsday Plane or the Looking Glass, with Looking Glass technology. And they put them up in the air. And passengers on these planes actually included Warren Buffett and Brent Scowcroft, two very, very highly placed insiders in the secret government, I suppose.
Right.
So in a sense, they were drilling for, well, let's see, if we really pull off this continuity of government coup and wipe out or decapitate was the word they used back in the 80s, decapitate the constitutional government and put in our own revolutionary government or our own dictatorship, we want to have those people ready on hand to just take the ball, you know. So in this case, let's put Warren Buffett and Brent Scowcroft in the command seat. And they actually drilled that. Another one was Positive Force 01, U.S. Joint Forces Command, U.S. CENTCOM, et cetera, and 40 agencies. I think I mentioned this. This is a continuity of government attack, which includes an attack on the transportation system and terrorist groups hijacking commercial airlines and flying them into the Pentagon.
Right.
Positive Force, then the next one is invasion of Afghanistan and Pakistan. Well, now we're getting down to the geopolitics.
Right.
We want Afghanistan because we want a pipeline that will take oil and gas out of the stands that are recently liberated by the breakup of the Soviet Union, the Caspian Basin area. We want those to go to our boats and to our clients. We want to control the spigot of oil and gas. And so Afghanistan, even though it's incredibly rough terrain, You know, you look at a map, it's flat, you just draw a line.
Right.
Make a pipeline. Well, that's, you know, they haven't made any progress in Afghanistan in the last 15 years of war. That's what the military experts say, the people
right.
in command, they've made no progress, except they've guarded the pipelines.
Right, and grew a lot of poppy.
They've grown a lot of opium, heroin, et cetera. That's,
right.
that's now the center of that trade in the world. So a dozen agencies on April 17th through 26th and NORAD cooperated in the Unified Vision 01 operation, which is the invasion of Afghanistan and Pakistan. And they prepared it by calling it Operation Enduring Freedom. Occurred on October 2001. So as soon as, you know, of course, 9/11 happened, what happened in, within an hour, Osama bin Laden was blamed by, you know,
right.
the top TV networks. Everybody agreed that Osama bin Laden did it. Bush got up there, said, you know, this is not going to stand. We're going to, you know, want it dead or alive. And so then in October, 1 month later, we launched this invasion, an occupation of
uh-huh.
Afghanistan, which is still occurring. Now, here's an interesting one. The FBI CIA Anti-Terrorist Task Force was moved in a drill to California, to Monterey, which supposedly diverted top FBI, CIA, and a terrorist special operations agents, along with a lot of heavy equipment, from the Boston, New York City, Washington area, where they might have done some good, theoretically. To Monterey. Well, I tend to look at this as kind of covering their butts, but I don't know, you know. Because if they've got something like this, it does kind of cover their butts. You know, well, we had to be at a conference in Monterey,
That's
so
right.
sorry, guys. You know.
That's right.
But of course, they knew it was coming down because they're involved in planning the other steps. You know?
Right.
So another one, the test of readiness at NORAD, which is in Cheyenne Mountain. It's a drill. Vigilant Guardian NORAD annual readiness drill occurred on the day of 9/11. This was called... Able Danger as well, full battle staff levels to test entire organizations. And those 3-foot doors that, you know, close at the mouth of the underground bunker there, closed
right.
on that day for the first and only time. And as we said earlier, it was Cheyenne Mountain that actually inserted the false radar blips into the NEED's computer screens. So Tarpley makes the assumption or the conclusion that the putschists or the coup leaders
right.
were right there in Cheyenne Mountain. And because they're doing these things like putting in false radar blips. Now that's a hypothesis, but it seems to fit a lot of data. And I'm not gonna, you know, say for sure that that's the case, but it seems like it's very possible. Another group is indoctrination of first responders. Including 600 local first responders in the Shanksville, Pennsylvania area, as well as New Jersey on 9/11. They were prepped for the 9/11 invasion or attacks. Another one was assemble and silence unreliable outside contractors at the WTC. So you got these other businesses in the World Trade Center, how are you going to manage them? So the fiduciary trust company on the 97th floor of the South Tower called a meeting to assemble and silence all the unreliable outside contractors. And then you have the aerial surveillance of the president during the coup, the day of. This is conducted by AWACS, the Air Warning and Control System drill, which went live, and it was ordered by NORAD Commander Larry Arnold on 9/11. Two AWACS aircrafts from Tinker Air Force Base, Oklahoma, were sent over Washington, D.C. and Florida to surveil the Capitol and the president during the coup. So these are the, you know, big spy planes, the big white planes that we've perhaps read about, kind of a Air Command, Pentagon command system in the sky. You can read about those big white planes on many articles. And then there's a response to biochemical attacks, which might have something to do with the anthrax, I don't know. And then there's a couple that are unknown. But the major players here are NORAD and the Air Force and all the intelligence agencies. And again, my scenario here is that Let me get down to the continuity of government scenario, and then let's have a discussion about this,
Right.
If you don't mind. Remember the good old Iran-Contra scandal of the 80s?
Good old Iran-Contra, yeah.
Yes, okay, well, let me sum it up real quickly. President Reagan had just been elected in 1980, took office January 1981, I think. Within 69 days, there was an assassination attempt on his life by a guy named John Hinckley, who happens to that family's family friends, close family friends in the oil business with the Bush family. Golly,
right.
George H.W. Bush is the vice president who would stand to gain from the disablement or the death of Reagan. Well, it turns out, according to Tarpley, that this also occurred during a drill. The actual assassination attempt occurred during a presidential succession drill in which they were practicing the succession of presidents. And, well, there's John Hinckley, who's probably somewhat mind-controlled or paid off or something. But he tried to cook Reagan. He didn't, but he did a lot to incapacitate Reagan. Reagan was already an old guy. And to me, he was never that smart. He was an actor.
Yeah, he's so an actor.
He was perfect at projecting, you know, what the power elite wanted people to believe. But anyway, so I would suggest that George H.W. Bush, son of Prescott Bush, son of Samuel Prescott Bush, three generations of Skull and Bones, I would suggest that George H.W. Bush was the de facto head of the country for almost all of the Reagan administration, as well as his own presidential administration of only 4 years. So close to 12 years for George H.W. Bush, who's a key player in all this and everything else. And his family has four generations of dealing death and destruction through the armaments industry. They're all bound up with the military-industrial complex. So anyway, so George Bush is the one who really kind of oversees what's happening in the 80s. He had been the head of the CIA in 1976. And he was all too familiar with the continuity of government scenario. He used those powers during that time. And he put together a group, including Richard Cheney, Donald Rumsfeld, and Oliver North, to make plans for the, what's the word here? My own, I can't even remember already. Make plans for the suspension of government. Now, concomitant with that, simultaneously, and this involves a whole bunch of military protocols and drills like the others, one of those was Operation Rex, which is short for Readiness Exercise of 1984, and it was a classified drill and scenario to detain large numbers of Americans who are deemed, quote, national security threats.
Right.
If the president declares a state of emergency, and you go after these people for their subversive activities. This was reported on in 1984 by the Spotlight newspaper and the Herald, Miami Herald of 1987. And then it came out in the Iran-Contra hearings of 1987 when Oliver North, who was a key man on all this stuff, I'll outline the Iran-Contra in a second. But Oliver North was asked if he'd been involved in drawing up the continuity of government plans. And his lawyer said, you know, Mr. Speaker, who is Daniel Inouye of Hawaii, and Inouye came to his rescue and says, well, I don't think we can discuss that here, you know. And so it was shown, but he said, we can discuss that in private, but not in public. So it was shown, yeah, it's a pretty good indication they were talking about that he was working on a plan for continuity of government.
Right.
Which actually resulted in the formation of the Federal Emergency Military Authority. That's what FEMA was at first, the Federal Emergency Military Authority. Now we've changed it to the Federal Emergency Management Agency. But it was military authority before it was management agency, and it had to do with all these concentration camps that people keep, you know,
right,
pointing at in this country, you know. So they've got their plans for continuity of government to do what to do now with those subversives. And I know you've done an excellent program on the Jade Helm, which just brings all of this right up to date on a more massive scale. So Yeah, and then Iran-Contra, which precipitated this Senate hearing, was the U.S. government was doing all kinds of shady, well, the CIA, as usual.
As
the
usual.
CIA and their business contacts were, in fact, arming Iran, which is supposed to be our enemy. Israel, too, of course, was a big player in this. And, of course, it was the Bush and Reagan administration that managed to convince the Iranian government to hold on to the hostages until the day that Ronald Reagan was released, and thus ensure the election for Reagan rather than Carter. So they're actually manipulating election results. The CIA has only gotten more brazen since Alan Dulles was the head in 1953, and more powerful. And that is kind of clued in. We're clued in on that. We talked about this book a little. Fletcher Prouty was very high in Army intelligence, and he wrote a book called The Secret Team, the CIA and its allies in control of the United States and the world.
Wow.
So that gives you a sense. I mean, you know, and he talks about how the CIA got the whole Vietnam War going from the very outset, you know. And, you know, it just answers a lot of questions for us who live through these things without getting the straight story.
Right.
And now we're trying to kind of catch up and get that straight story. But meanwhile, the U.S. government was also arming a group of terrorists in Nicaragua who were hired by the U.S. CIA and others to overthrow the leftist Sandinista government. And they figured, well, why not? Well, and of course, the Congress had passed the Bolin Amendment saying, you can't do that, Reagan. Reagan, you can't start a war in Nicaragua. Reagan was pounding the drums, and they said, no, we vote no. Well, it didn't stop them. They went right ahead, and they did all this covertly. And they had Joseph Coor's airplanes, you know, ticking guns down there. And they thought, well, let's complete the loop here. We'll take private groups and the military will bring lots and lots of guns to the Sandinistas, and we'll train them over here in the country next door, which is Honduras, and then we'll send them in there to just wreck the economy of Nicaragua, which they did, and impose a terrorism on the people, for sure.
Sure.
Low-intensity conflict and out-and-out war. And meanwhile, let's complete the circle by, you know, bringing lots and lots of drugs back into this country in CIA DC-10 airplanes, flying them into Mena, Arkansas, among other places, while Bill Clinton is the governor.
Right.
And then flying all those drugs over to San Francisco and then down to Los Angeles and fueling the crack cocaine boom for the black people. And in other words, they're always wanting to destabilize things. They're always wanting, you know, the... there's lots of acronyms for the CIA, you know, chaos-inducing agencies, criminals in action, cocaine in America,
right,
cults in America, these kinds of things. I mean, they're quite more accurate, you know.
Right.
But, so all this was going on then back in the 80s under Reagan, which is really under Bush, because he was the guy with the, you know, with the contacts, and his brain was working a little better. I don't know how much, but working better.
Right.
And so at that point, Rumsfeld and Cheney are fairly young guys, and they're also working on these continuity of government, suspension of the Constitution of the United States. And so they know all the protocols. Well, in the 90s, those two guys go into business. One's head of Halliburton, and I think Cheney was head of Halliburton, big oil servicing operation that made out like a bandit in Iraq, of course, and got all the contracts on no-bid contracts. So we're talking phenomenal corruption here. And then Donald Rumsfeld, I think a Searle Chemical Company, he was CEO of that. And there's pictures of him shaking hands with Saddam Hussein as he's selling him all these chemical warfare chemicals.
This is when he got aspartame approved.
Yes, aspartame, but things more deadly yet.
Yeah.
You know, including the chemical weapons that we actually did. So, you know, we know he's got chemical weapons because we sold it to him.
Right.
You know?
We have the receipts.
Right. Yeah, we got the receipts right.
Right.
So anyway, Rumsfeld and Cheney then were in on the ground floor of planning continuity of government. It just so happens that on the day of 2001, they're both back in action in Washington, D.C., Cheney as Secretary of Defense,
Cheney was the Vice President.
As Secretary of Defense. Right. And these were the guys who took over the continuity of government operations from Washington, D.C.
Right.
Isn't that another coincidence?
It's amazing.
So that's my real hypothesis, is that 911, among other things, an excuse to go to war in the Middle East and just take over the whole area and impose a draconian police
right.
state at home in America with, you know, the Patriot Act and all these other acts, also practice for the coming event, which a terrorist event, which might make 911 look pretty small. Now, this is where it gets interesting, because if these guys are willing to, you know, go to nuclear war with Russia and China off this operation, what are they willing to do on the next one? And my gut level, no proof at all, I've done a little research on Operation Bluebeam, which is... faked alien attack.
Yeah.
And or faked second coming of Christ.
Or both,
right. which then would... usher in the continuity of government, the completed coup of Wall Street and the rogue network, the invisible government taking over constitutional Republic of America and having their way. Now, unfortunately, when you listen to the YouTube presentation on the doomsday plan, America's doomsday plan, they started with saying, we're looking at the killing off of 3/4 of the American people. That's the first thing that's on that. Check it out, the YouTube. The America's Doomsday Plan. There's a guy saying that. That's the first thing. And then he gets into the, you know, Cheyenne Mountain bunker and, you know, the 3-foot door and,
right.
you know, all this incredible Air Force power in the world. Well, I mean, he doesn't explain where the 3/4 loss of our population would actually come from. He doesn't
right.
tell us what would cause that. But they're planning for that, you see.
Right.
So I don't like that they're planning for that.
No.
And, because bottom line, America is the world power. And if it happens, it's because we made it happen.
Mm-hmm.
By the way, the two schools of thought on the 911 from the 911 Truth Committee or Truth Movement is make it happen on purpose, my hop, and let it happen on purpose. And for a long time there was a debate, but there's no debate. It's make it happen on purpose, my hop. That's
right.
what it is and always was and always will be. It was an inside job. It was also psy-op. It was
mm-hmm.
trauma-based mind control to get the Americans to go along with these wars of revenge against that bad Osama bin Laden. And then pretty soon Saddam Hussein was responsible for the 911 attack. So now we got to go get Iraq. And that's all based on just pure lies. You know, the cooked intelligence that Saddam had nuclear weapons. He didn't have nuclear weapons. He didn't have squat. Because
right.
in the 1991 war, when George Bush's father took out, you know, Iraq and
right.
In the operation, in the Gulf War, Operation Desert Storm, they had a no-fly zone imposed for 10 years. They're bombing the hell out of the people of Iraq. They'd already killed 1.5 million people in Iraq
right.
by the time we invaded again in 2003. And now I'm sure there's probably 3 or 4 million dead. Out of a country of 22 million, there's only 18 million left.
Right.
So that's genocide by any stretch of the imagination. So our nation, our tax dollars, we have to admit this. We have to own up to this.
Right.
Our tax dollars have paid for the genocide of probably 4 million Iraqis in a most, you know, horrendous way of suffering. You know, there's an old saying, killing one person is murder, and killing a million is foreign policy.
Yeah.
yeah. I'm afraid that's, you know, Americans buy it because our experts tell us it's okay. Well, all of this is to preserve, according to Tarpley, the Anglo-American alliance, the British... City of London alliance
yeah.
with Wall Street. So anyway, that's I thank you very much, Paul. I really enjoy our back and forth. But now that I've laid out, I think this scenario, this hypothesis. Let's hear from you. See what you think.
Okay. Well, this sounds a lot more than just a hypothesis. It sounds like proven dead to rights. If there was some way to prosecute these guys, if there was a court. In the world, in the United States, you could bring these guys to justice. We certainly have them have a case simply based on these 46 exercises.
I think that this is some of the best, most solid evidence out there. If you see an exercise going on at the same time as a terrorist event,
right?
It's a slam dunk,
right?
You know, that drill went live. You know, this is not possibly a coincidence. All that's the way the press, you know, tries to spin these things.
Right. Well, what would be, you know? You said when we were going through this that the odds of all these things taking place on the same day, and it's just amazing. It's way beyond coincidence. It would be one in hundreds of millions odds of that happening.
Yeah, I think it's not even possible.
No, I don't think it is. And you add this with the fact that there was no evidence of a plane crashing into the Pentagon or in Pennsylvania.
Or in the World Trade Center. The planes did not hit the World Trade Center. I believe my website has an article about faked video images of planes inserted into a false photographic image of downtown Manhattan that day. Be easy for somebody at a computer station to just insert a false image. And then, of course, this is really a made-for-TV event.
Right.
And then you have your actors on the ground.
Right.
Coached as to what to say when, and the CNN and Fox News are the principal news agencies that are in on it.
Right.
And then, of course, they put out the images and everybody else takes those images. So pretty soon it's a monolithic story.
Right.
We watch those towers come down again and again and again. That's a trauma-based mind control part.
That's right. Yeah. There is a YouTube that I've seen where somebody analyzed one of the planes coming in, and they screwed up, and one of the wings goes behind a nearby building.
Did you
see that one?
I didn't see that, but I've seen the evidence of video fakery, and I'm convinced by it. It's impossible for a plane made mostly out of aluminum to actually punch a hole in a building made out of concrete and steel.
Yeah.
This is two of the strongest buildings ever made in 1976. And many people think they were actually engineered to come down. The Rockefeller built them.
Sure.
And many people think that they, you know, that this plot was already planned back when they were built in 1976.
Yeah, well, 30 years.
Yep.
They probably started the planning when they started the building. Yeah, I always think it's like I've worked for a lot of aerospace companies, and it would be like taking a beer can and slamming it into a concrete wall. I mean, planes are made.
Right.
They're made to be light. So.
Exactly.
So it's totally off the wall. I think that this is such important information that you and Webster Tarpley have put together. That, you know, it's undeniable evidence. It's all based on documented facts, newspaper articles. It blew me away with the NORAD blips. The fact that they put blips on a radar screen, I mean, that's got to be a major offense in any court of law to do that, because you can really do some major harm. So, go ahead.
No, you please. Yeah.
Well, if I don't know whether we're going to get much traction on pursuing the 911. I mean, people they've even made a museum, you know, where at Ground Zero, where this whole thing took place, and it reinforces the story of what happened.
Right. Yeah.
So it's going to be very difficult to pull the public off of this one. But the one we can really prepare for, which is the one you mentioned before, we've done some videos on it, the Project Blue Beam, Alien Messiah, Intergalactic War kind of scenario. And as you said before, if you think 911 was amazing with 46 coordinated exercises, It's going to be nothing compared to this one, where you're going to see holographic images, voice-to-skull transmissions, and it's going to be amazing. People are predicting something like that for the day before the election, actually.
Yeah. Well, and of course, that's the reason why I think it's worth our time to try to expose these things. The more people that can kind of penetrate this fog of disinformation to the real story, the better, well, the less the catastrophe might be.
Right.
I don't know why, but that three-quarter figure of the American population kind of sticks in my mind, you know, I know that this is what New Agers have been calling for a long time. Okay. So there is a religious component behind this that we really need to not ignore. This is a very, very well thought out takeover plan by a fairly small minority of people on the planet. I happen to think that many of those people are kind of commandeered by powers and principalities of the dark side. I've got a whole series on the New World Religion, and you go back in history and you see that these secret societies, Theosophy, etc., Madame Blavatsky, and Ordo Templi Orientis, and all these secret societies, the Illuminati, the big one, they're very much into theurgy, which is channeling spirits.
Right.
And for the power that it's going to give them. Well, and then George Bush and his father would have, laid in the coffin at the tomb at Yale University to go through the initiation to become members of this elite Skull and Bones Society. Right. Well, some people think that that is simply the American extension of the Illuminati. Well, they both call themselves the Order of Death.
Right.
So these people... they love it. They love death. They get off on death. The more people they can kill, the better they are. There's a science in the military now called thanatology, the science of death. And you get people like, Aquino, who's very...
Michael Aquino.
What's his first name?
Isn't it Michael?
Yeah, Michael Aquino. He was he founded the Temple of Set, which is a blatantly satanic organization. And it's recognized religion in the Pentagon.
Yeah, I heard that he got thrown out of the Church of Satan because he was too evil.
I can believe that. He was at the Presidio in California, right next to San Francisco, right in San Francisco, and he was accused of a lot of systematic molestation of children. The whole bit, rape and, torture and everything. This is where a lot of this comes from. It comes from pedophilia. It comes from trauma-based mind control of children. Mm-hmm. I've got an article on my 911 New World Order site about the history and application of mind control. And again, this goes back, way back, thousands of years. The Illuminati families are certainly involved in this, and they do it to their own children.
Absolutely.
And so their own children would be then fractured personalities, which would have... this. Remember the two-headed eagle and the Janus figure with two heads. Well, many of these Illuminati are just, a Catholic priest or a Protestant minister in their nice life.
Right.
And then in their in their occult life, they're going to rituals and sacrificing babies.
Right.
You couldn't ask for a crazier scenario than what we have in the world we live in. And of course, this is below the surface. I remember quoting a couple times in one of our interviews, an article in Time magazine, to understand what happened to Jean Benet, little girl out of Boulder, I think, who was killed, is to understand the world we live in. And we cannot conceive of evil, such an evil.
That's right. It's very dark.
Very, very, very dark. So, everything comes from something. And, I think the people at the top of these institutions, well, the CFR, mm-hmm. 4,000, 6,000 members of the CFR, they would commandeer all these major institutions.
Right.
Who are those guys? How did they get where they are? And what's their network,
Right.
And does it Does it include this network of secret societies and pedophiles? And I think it does. And I think some of the products of that nowadays, Obama himself may be a victim of that kind of childhood, might be completely mind controlled. That there's a book about that.
Oh, I don't think you'd have a person this close to implementing the world order. I don't think you'd have anybody that had any mind of their own in a position like that. I think he's absolutely mind controlled on some level. I was listening to an interesting YouTube video last night by a guy named Dr. Cat Eye, and Mr. Cat Eye. And he was talking about this, there's a quote in Ecclesiastics.
Ecclesiastes, yeah.
Yeah, and it talks about powers and principalities. Well, right. Come to find out that powers and principalities are levels of angels. They're levels 8 and 9 under, you know, the seraphim, the cherubims, and the powers and principalities. So we're up against... I really hope that this video wakes people up to what happened on 9/11, what they're capable of, and now with a totally mind-controlled population. I mean, you look at these social justice warriors and how their mind processes what's going on. You don't have people that can even think now. So we have a population that's unable to think. We have a government that's very much controlled by a dark force. I mean, and it's coming out more and more. So what they can pull off now with Operation Bluebeam is going to be totally, totally amazing. And I don't even know how you get ready for it. You know, you talked about a great population decrease. Dr. Deagle, do you know who that is? Mm-hmm. He came out with statistics, projected population statistics. And the United States dropped by about it's either 1 or 2/3. So they're predicting a major drop in population. So whatever happens will probably happen on American soil. And we're the people that produce the video false flags. I mean, this 911 was totally a CNN. Well, you know, it was given to the public by a very much controlled news media.
Yeah.
So we're really set up for something major now, and we should all be. It's no longer research this and research. It's no longer a hobby now. It's going to be a big part of your life, and you really need to catch on to what's going on, what's been done to you, and now what they're planning. Do you want to talk a little bit about what you know about Bluebeam, and we can go through that?
Well, on my website, 911nwo.com, I quote a fellow named William Ross Dean, or maybe I think it's William Dean Ross.
Okay, one or the other.
These intelligence, maybe this isn't the best example, because sometimes these intelligence operatives, case officers, will adopt a name with two first names in a row. This guy's got three first names in a row. But anyway, he says he was a psychic warrior back in the late 1990s, and he was involved in a lot of the remote viewing and really psychic warrior stuff. And he was privy to some of the kind of New Age plans, which merged New Age thinking with our Department of Defense in order to, again, depopulate the world. Because they think there's too many people. And not only that, they don't need us anymore, because they're going to have robots and already do, and cyborgs. And they've been working on this for many decades.
Uh-huh.
So it's just time to get rid of those pesky human beings. And evolve to the next level. So you get people like Barbara Marx Hubbard, the New Age lady, who's also in this, you know, Earth Battalion with the U.S. Army. That's, you know, and she's made statements like, well, you don't have to worry about choosing who's going to live and die. We'll do that for you, you know.
Wow.
that's our job. And she couches this, of course, in all this New Age terminology, that humans are evolving now to a new species, a higher species, and we're going to have to get rid of those people who can't ascend. you see, ascend to the new higher levels. And so there's this whole new age ideology, methodology, and rhetoric behind what's going on right. with the military, or what the military evidently is planning on. And, you know, U.S. is now the superpower. We have our bases and our troops in, I think, you know, 160 out of 195 countries. We've got our bases surrounding Russia and China.
Right.
There's a funny little cartoon that says, you know, why did Russia put their country so near our bases?
Right.
We got all I've seen that. Right on borders, you know. Well, I mean, this is to take over the world, you know, obviously. This is the New World Order. This is the plan.
Right.
This is the long-term Illuminati plan, I think. This is the, you know, the Masons, the Zionists, the Illuminati. This is the secret societies. This is the people who want it all and believe they're gods, you see, because, you know, we're not, and they are. And, of course, that's a load of garbage, you know. But that's what they tell themselves. And, of course, it's the lie that the serpent gave to Eve in the garden. You know, you can be as gods, and surely you will never die, and all this stuff, you know. So these guys have bought into that lie. They're Satanists,
right.
big time, at the top. And I don't see them turning into nice guys next week. You know, I don't see them going to, you know, 12-step program to become
human.
Normal human beings.
Yeah. I don't see it happening either. The New Age religion really parallels Satanism so many ways. The basic tendencies or tenets are the same. The worship of the creator, making God out of people. Moral relativity. You know, everybody has everybody's right from their standpoint. There's no right and wrong. And what's another one?
It's your truth. Yeah.
Yeah. It's social Darwinism. They need Darwinism so they can say, well, we're better than you. That's why we can decide who lives and dies. And that's why we can execute eugenics against you useless eaters.
Well, now that's a good point. I mean, who's the father of modern eugenics? Well, it goes back to the Rockefellers in the early 20th century.
Absolutely.
And they handed it off to Hitler, who took it another step. And then those Hitler Nazi psychiatrists and monsters like Joseph Mengele. Then the space program, Wernher von Braun and all those guys, 5,000 Nazi scientists were smuggled into the Americas through Operation Paperclip, which is well known now.
Right.
This then became the basis of the CIA's MKUltra and other mind control experiments and programs, which just made it more kind of scientific. But, you know, to tell you the truth, Paul, I wasn't really sure that Satan existed. But after I read this stuff about mind control, I have no doubt.
Yeah.
There's no way that a human being could do that to another human being if he was not satanically energized.
Right.
It is so brutal and cruel. It's so off the chart. People need to realize that Satan exists. And he's been around a long time. He's smarter than us. Very devious. And, of course, his main tools are deception and terror.
Right.
Which our own government now does very well, deception and terror. To control us. So I'm afraid, you know, and I think the real question for you and I now is, okay, now what? What do we do
right.
now that we know this, you know? Well, obviously education is very important. I don't know, as you say, if you can prepare for this. You know, getting a bunch of, you know, cabinets full of food and getting some extra water bottles, it doesn't seem like it's, you know, might do that much good.
Right.
But hold your place, I think, is important. I think keep your faith is important for me.
Me too.
Believe that God is, you know, greater than anything that Satan can do. But also realize that Satan thinks he's going to win this final battle.
Right.
And that's one of the reasons why he's made all these satanic super soldiers. Because he only got one-third of the fallen angels, one-third of the angels, according to the Bible. And so his troops are kind of a little weaker than God's, you might say.
Oh, yes. Oh, yes.
So he wants to get all these other, you know, satanically energized beings on his side, and he intends to win.
Right.
And I don't believe he will. I do believe that the Book of Revelations kind of maps out the you know, the storyline and the ending, fortunately for us. You know, in other words, we can have faith that the good guys, God, Jesus will triumph in the end. But meanwhile, we've got some hard times, probably
right.
Not too far from
right.
the future.
We had, I want to go in a little bit to Project Bluebeam. They're going to use holographic images in the sky, voice to skull, to give you thoughts, to make you think that God is talking to you. I don't know whether they're going to stage a war. They certainly can bring images into your house through coaxial cables, which is what they're planning on doing. It's a whole, it's trying to make you crazy so you don't know what to do, and you'll happily sign up to go to a FEMA camp or go into New World Order. We had an interesting Skype call yesterday from some people in a Nordic country, and they're starting to wake up to what's going on, and they were kind of panic-stricken, and they really wanted Mindy and I to talk to them and calm them down. I'm not sure we did. But one thing that we're all kind of disarmed going into this thing, because we're not languaged for dealing with a spiritual war. And that's also part of the, I don't know, it's a liberal agenda, the New Age agenda, I don't know what agenda it is, but they certainly have taken Satan out of the vocabulary. People don't know who Lucifer is, even people that go to church, they don't realize that he's, that's another name for Satan. Also, our culture is devoid of any type of concepts dealing with demons. And demons are a very real and key player, going to be key players in this upcoming deception. So I think one thing would be to, what got me to realize it was listening to Mark Passio, who used to be a satanic priest. And he's broken from that, and he's allowing us to see how they think and how they do things. And that really helped me language what we're going through and move toward listening, reading the Bible and understanding how it's scripted to go. And they seem to be pretty much following that script, I think. So
yeah, well, you know, we all need our allies and we need our experts. We've got to cut through the garbage and get to the people who really know something.
Right.
And I have been very, very grateful to have discovered Tex Mars of his
right.
Power of Prophecy program. I've got many of his books and I've got many of his programs on a CD. He was a 22-year Air Force officer. Also, he's a Christian minister. Also, he's an expert on robots. He has been a college professor in war game scenarios. So he always, even he says when he was a kid, has been looking at geopolitics,
right.
and combining it with biblical prophecy. And I think he is a bit of a prophet himself because he's so well steeped in the Bible and in politics. He's about, you know, he's several years older than me, but he seems to be going strong. You see him on lots of YouTubes on the internet. You know, look up Tex Mars and you'll learn a lot of this background. He's written 4 books on the New Age movement. He exposed that. So we need our allies. We need people we can rely upon. And that's, I think, the big challenge is separating the truth from the lies. And, of course, Joseph Goebbels said, the truth is the greatest enemy of the state. So the state is coming down real hard on
right.
the side of the lies. And that's really what the CIA and the media do. They lie.
Right.
And of course, that puts us all at a kind of a disadvantage if we're looking over here and it's coming from over here, you know.
Right. Right. One of the things that I did learn, and I do keep my eye on, and these gentlemen from that talked to us yesterday, they said, well, what about all the holy books? What about the Bible and the Quran and the da 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 da? How should we approach them? And my advice was the only individual that the satanic force, Satanists, mock, criticize, blaspheme is Jesus Christ. I mean, it's the only one. They don't have an issue with Buddha. They don't have an issue with Shiva, Ganesh, no problem. The only one they come after, the only one they blaspheme is Jesus Christ, which means to me that that's the other side of the equation. You know, if you're looking at the Satanists in government and what they're trying to do to us, and murdering and having sex with children and those things, I mean, you've got to know there's a morality, there's a right and wrong, and that's wrong. And they're opposed to Jesus Christ, which seems to be the other side. Now, you know, I'm new to this Christianity thing. I think I finally picked it up in March last year. So I'm new, but it just seems to make more and more sense as we go forward, and we're lost in a mix of an incredibly powerful, deceitful government that controls the media and everything goes into our minds, that's controlled the schools so much so that kids not only have moral relativity, but they have reality relativity. They don't know what's real. So that would be my only case for introducing Christianity or thinking about it, besides the fact that it's the only scenario with a positive ending.
Absolutely. Yeah. Well, that's a big one. You know, it's the Bible is a very interesting and sometimes confusing document, but this is the conclusion that William Ross Dean, that psychic warrior, came to as well. He got the heck out of the operation that he was in and became a Christian, and you know, he had seen the dark side and realized that the only power that can overcome the dark side is Jesus Christ, and he, according to the New Testament, came to destroy the works of the devil. So apparently in a cosmic level he has already done so, but there's yet to be another major battle, and I do believe that Christ will emerge. I do believe that their goal is to usher in the satanic kingdom on the world. In other words, a very, very tiny elite rules, everybody else is killed or is a slave.
Right.
And the elite will have everything, they will have all the resources, they'll have all the land. But it won't be very long, according to the Book of Revelations, that they're able to kind of hold the power. They bring in their Antichrist, who appears as a wonderful savior for many, but he's a false savior, and things only get worse from there. You know, so yeah, this is all kind of mapped out in the New Testament, in the Book of Revelations. Whether or not one believes it is their own choice, but as you say, it. It almost seems like they're following the Bible as a roadmap. You know, again, this combination of geopolitics and biblical prophecy of politics and religion.
Right.
You know, is what's happening. It's not just politics and it's not just religion. They're together. You know, the Zionist movement is very critical in all of this. Adolf Hitler seems to have been possessed. You know, I mean, there's lots of examples in which and of course the evangelicals, who are totally supporting Zionism and have just rewritten the Bible in their own for their own you know, goals. These people are highly deluded. It's a very, very self-destructive delusion. They, you know, bought into prosperity consciousness and all this very anti-biblical.
We should really interject something about a disclaimer about Christianity, because I considered it to be a relationship and not a religion, because I know that religions have been the major mind control up to this point, up to the 21st century. All of these religions, including Christianity, I mean, if you look at the beginning of Christianity, it was made a state religion right away and used to control people by Constantine. And then down through the years, modified by the various popes to do various things. So it's very dangerous for us to say embrace Christianity. You have to be very careful, because I would say, well, you know, there's 38,000 Christian churches on the world. And I would say most of them, maybe 99%, are leading you astray. There's what is it, 24,000 priests and preachers who have signed up to join FEMA and work in the camps when they take them in. And those people are, that's amazing. That's amazing. So if you're following them, you're going to be following them to a FEMA camp. So it's a dangerous thing to for us even to recommend, but it's also dangerous for us not to, you know? So go ahead.
Well, I think it's a great point. Tex Mars, who I listened to, he started out as an evangelical when he got, you know, born again and saved.
Right.
Then he came to realize that the evangelicals were, you know, way off base on many things. They're following the Scofield Bible, which was written by a shyster, you know, who was paid by rich Jews, really, to make a commentary that favored Israel and
right.
just changed the whole, you know, key meanings of the Bible. And subsequently, there have been many other translations.
Right.
And Tex is one of these King James, you know, kind of.
Right.
He's a King James man, he says. But yeah, the Baptists, he says, the Southern Baptists, a very, very large component of the Protestant church, a very, very high percentage of the priests or the ministers are also Freemasons. And if one looks
there
at
you
the
go.
Freemasonry, you see that at the highest levels, well, even right from the beginning, people don't know it, but you're being initiated through steps into pure Satanism. It's
right.
based on the Jewish Kabbalah, which is a system of black magic that goes back to Egypt and Babylon.
Right.
And the Jews who were in their captivity in ancient Babylon, which is now Iraq, learned this system of black magic from the priests of Babylon, and it was the worship of Baal, and it was the sacrifice of children.
Right.
It was just a whole bunch of, you know, black magic incantation stuff. Well, Bill Clinton, Hillary Clinton, Madonna, Britney Spears, according to text, a lot of people are wearing the little red wristband, you know, little
right.
String around. I don't know if it's your right or left hand, but that's showing their. Into the Kabbalah. Well, Kabbalah is black magic.
Right.
It's anti-reason. It's giving hexes to people. And it's getting what you want through magic and manipulation. It's very, very dark. And,
yes.
To have a Baptist minister who's also a Mason, he has to almost be double-minded then, too, because
right.
he's looking at the world through two different lenses at the same time, which is, strictly speaking, I don't think possible, but these guys learn to split their mind like that, and that really is the essence of Satanism, to be double-minded. And so that's why James in the New Testament, Brother Jesus said, don't be double-minded, you know.
Right.
Be single-minded, you know, and follow Jesus. And I totally agree with you. It's a relationship. And we can have the faith. It's actually, you know, the doctrine that I tend to subscribe to is, it's an act of grace on God's part that you will have faith. In other words, the initiating step comes from God through grace, and then you develop the faith. And of course, if there's that instant of conversion, you know, you repent and you say, hey,
right.
hey, I'm not perfect. You ask for forgiveness,
right.
and then you try to reorient your life along the lines of the Ten Commandments and Jesus's two commandments.
Right.
Love God and love your fellow man. Let's call it the 12 commandments.
Right.
And, you know, we're all very imperfect, and it doesn't mean that we didn't do rotten things along the way. What it means is those rotten things are forgiven by Jesus,
right.
who died in our place, essentially. You know, they call it the Holy Bible, and the idea is God's holy. So he wants holy beings in his heaven.
Right.
And so this, I look at this as kind of like this is our pilgrimage through, it's certainly not hell, but it's a very interesting mix of heaven and hell here
right.
on this planet. And we get a chance to orient ourselves with kind of those two magnetic poles, you know.
Right.
God to the north and if you will, Satan to the south. And there's a lot of people who are on that left-hand path, which is
right.
which is the path of black magic, and leads to eternal damnation. So I personally don't see, you know, why people would make such a decision. But obviously, if you're in a generational family and you're brought
right.
up
Right.
You know, with this kind of mind control, trauma-based mind control and abuse, maybe you don't have a choice. You know,
right.
I think that's what's really sad. The Illuminati families, the kids don't have a choice. They're inducted into this with rituals, you know, going to sacrifices of human beings. And it's really hard to imagine how bad it is.
Right. Even our culture that prides fame and fortune is like a recruiting mechanism for the satanic elite, because they can offer you that, you know, if you make the right deal with them. So the game's kind of rigged against us. And I think it's very few of us lucky ones who are able to find our way out. And I would hope that the people listening to this find their way out too.
Absolutely.
It's available to everybody, unless you're, well, even we know people that are severely mind controlled. They have multiples, they're trying to work their way out of it. We started reading, Mindy and I started reading The Brave New World again. If you want a sobering reality, just start that book, and you'll see what they have in mind for the human race. And it's shocking. And they're about to pull some major stuff. If you thought 9-1-1 was amazing, you ain't seen nothing yet. This new, it'll be an alien invasion. It might be a war. There might be an alien messiah that comes in and takes over. I'm not that familiar with the Bible, but it seems to me there are several antichrists that show up. Do you know, or does text talk about that?
Yeah, I think through history, you know, I don't know, maybe the Apostle Paul, who says those who are not, you know, for Christ are antichrist.
Right,
so
right.
That means a lot of people through history. And of course, then Hitler's come along and they get, you know, labeled as the antichrist. But I tend to agree with, you know, the text that, you know, the real antichrist of the Bible is going to be a figure. I also believe that, you know, the beast that comes out of the earth and that comes out of the sea, there's going to be these holograms. This is going to be the image of the
right.
beast. We're going to worship the image of the beast. We're going to have to worship the image of the beast. So we're going to worship this thing in the sky or wherever it is that is actually not there. But it's kind of like, you know, the Wizard of Oz, you know,
right.
doing the, you know, working the dials and whatnot and projecting this image that everybody's supposed to worship, you know. And then really behind the curtain, there's this little old guy, you know, who's playing with
right.
the dials.
That's a really
little guy's probably a giant mountain, you know,
with the 3-foot doors. Yeah, that's an amazing little story about what's going on behind the curtain, because there's nothing there. It's just a little guy, and what he's promising us is to fulfill our desires. What do you want? I want to have courage. I want to have a heart. Well, you have it. You just have to turn and realize that you had it. God gave it to you.
Well, yeah, you know, and I think that the author of that book, what is his, Baum, was quite a theosophist. So he wrote a whole series of books, the Wizard of Oz series, and never really got rich, I don't think, but he put a lot of theosophy in those books. So if you go to another level, you'll see lots of even satanic symbolism there.
Right. Yeah, we should mention, since we brought up theosophy, this is a line of thinking, I don't know, a philosophy that probably was started by H.B. Blavatsky, and it followed down through Rudolf Steiner was another theosophist, and I know a lot about it because I started a Waldorf school once. Her publishing company was the Luciferian Publishing Company. So right from the beginning, they were laying the groundwork for the takeover of the dark side. And she went out and she reconstituted all the Eastern religions, which were losing converts. People were becoming Christians, especially in Japan. Japan was becoming a Christian nation before we bombed the two cities that were the epicenters of the burgeoning Christian movement there. This when you have a religion, and usually most of the New Age religions trace their lineage back to Theosophy or H.P. Blavatsky, either overtly or covertly, and so you need to watch out for your New Age gurus and those things. I know that's I hate to talk about that because it really, if someone's following a guru, it's like a cult of personality. You can't shake them loose, but be careful.
Yeah, when you read the kind of the thread of the New Age movement, you know, with Blavatsky and Alice Bailey and all her books. Alice Bailey and Helen Blavatsky both claim to have channeled their books from a spirit being called Duo Ko, which they call the Tibetan. And it's a demon. I mean, you know, and of course, many other series of books like Helen Schuckman's A Course in Miracle, also, supposed to be an alternative Bible, really, also channeled. Mm-hmm. And Eileen Cady over in Scotland with the, I think it's Findhorn community. This was really organized by British intelligence. It was as a cult. And Eileen Cady was channeling these books from some entity. So you got a lot of channeled books, people who are automatic writing and being told what to say.
Right.
Well, that's another pretty good evidence that there are demon spirits, you know.
Right.
And there's a lot of them out there, and it's, you need to kind of find your experts to deconstruct all the different New Age movements. Tex Mars, like I say, has written 4 books, and Constance Cumby has written a couple books on the New Age movement and the New Age religion, it's a front for Satanism. You know, it's kind of soft Satanism, and then as you go in deeper, it's just
right.
like the Masons.
Right.
Soft Satanism when you start, and hardcore Satanism when you finish. You know.
Well, it makes you really acceptable to that. I mean, there's no morality; it's all relative. Talking of the Course in Miracles. I had read that it was a CIA intervention. And
I think so. It was at Columbia University. The CIA was all over Columbia University at that time. Yeah.
And Marianne Williamson, who is the major leader proponent of that, is a member of the Club of Rome, as is Deepak Chopra. By the way, you can find who's members of the Club of Rome. They've got a website. And if you look down through there, your guru might appear. It was shocking to me to go through that list.
I'm really glad you said that, Paul. Let's talk about the Club of Rome for a second. This is one of the many globalist organizations, really kind of a cult by itself out of Europe. And the Limits to Growth book came out of there in the late 60s, I believe, which, used all these computer programs to tell us that, we're running out of resources and you better not have kids and, the end is near. And basically, now it's, of course, none of those predictions came true. And now we see that these computer models can be used to snow us.
Right.
And of course, the global warming thing is all based on these computer model projections. And it all depends on the assumptions you put into the computer model. It's called garbage in, garbage out. But these guys are very allied with the United Nations, which is also very globalist and also very satanic at heart. And they're the ones behind the global warming scam.
Okay? Absolutely.
They have a political agenda. They're not scientists. They want to change the world, into the Agenda 21 of Maurice Strong and the Rio Earth Summit, which is the agenda for the 21st century in which, all the rich countries are going to give all their money to all the poor countries so we're all the same, and these guys are going to control through all these nonprofit organizations and whatnot. And it's all laid out in the documents that came out of the Rio Earth Summit in 1992. And they are being implemented in this country
right.
and others, even though they were never passed by Congress or approved by the American people. In other words, it's soft law. And it's adopted by the U.S. Forest Service, and it's adopted by the U.S. Park Service, and all this stuff.
Right.
So the Club of Rome very much figures into the global warming fraud. And guess what? I think the Air Force does, too.
How so?
Wouldn't it? Well, chemtrails.
Oh, yeah.
Who's flying all those planes? Who's coordinating all the planes? got to be the Air Force. So here we have the Air Force as the main,
right,
main factor in the execution of Operation 911. It seems we have the Air Force perhaps as one of the main executioners of the chemtrails, the aerial spraying. We also have the Air Force involved in the HAARP zapping and other,
right,
things like that. They were involved right at the beginning. And then it seems we have the Air Force involved in Operation Bluebeam. All this cosmic, Galactica stuff, Federation of the White Brotherhood and all this crap, you know. All this stuff that people believe, New Agers believe,
right,
this stuff, you know. And they take names that are very, you know, biblical and satanic, and they say, well, you know, this group is going to, you know, save the world. And you know, we're going to channel beings from Arcturus, the star Arcturus, and we're going to channel beings from the constellation Pleiades. There's the Pleiades. I mean, all this is around where I live in Crystal, probably where he used to live. This was big in the 80s. But these people are just, you know, kind of, I think they're just kind of, well, they're marbles, you know, because what's being done is a psy-op on us all, you know, to get us ready for this coup, this transformation of power from the duly constituted constitutional government of the United States, which actually is supposed to serve the people in the government, according to the Constitution, and our rights are inalienable because they're given to us from God, and now throw that system and come in with your satanic dictatorship, your one world government, one world religion, which is the bottom line behind this stuff. And because they are so powerful, the Rothschilds, the Rockefellers, the Illuminati families, so rich, they gave all these other agencies to do pieces of their bidding. But I think it's with the help of these powers and principalities. I don't think these guys are smart enough to do all this by themselves.
Oh, I don't think so either. I think this is planned highly above Rumsfeld and Cheney. I mean, if you think that they could sit down and come up with a plan like this, I think you're giving them way too much credit. I think they're puppeted the same as everybody else following these orders. And also, I just have to mention that, you know, there's a lot of people at work probably for the Air Force and the CIA that really think they're serving the people. But when you start being an order follower, you get into a real problem because you're not serving your own conscience and you're not determining what's right and wrong. Somebody else is. And I'm of the mind that if you do something wrong, you can't say, you know, I was ordered to do this. It didn't work in the Nuremberg trials, and I don't think it's going to work in any other trial. I think you're responsible for your actions. And if you're ordered to do something that's immoral, you're doing something immoral. Actually, I think that the ruling elite think that they're going to get off easy because they didn't do these things. They ordered you to do them. So I really blame the order followers. So if you're in a position, if you're in the Air Force, if you're in the military, and you're the order follower, you're the one, in the eyes of God, that's doing the action. So wake up to that reality.
That's a very good point. As you said, the Nuremberg trials considered the German people guilty for the crimes that Germany did. You know, and of course, a lot of the good Germans were what? You know, I was just following orders. Of course, you know, in a fair Nuremberg trial, the American soldiers would have been just as guilty, you know.
Right.
You know, to take the loser and say you're guilty is just, you know, kind of
right,
standard operating procedure. But, you know, in that regard, I think there's a very interesting experiment that Stanley Milgram did, a psychology professor, I think at Harvard years ago. And he set up an experiment, which has been duplicated, replicated many times, wherein you have a scenario where a guy in a white lab coat is standing up, and he's giving directives to another person who is actually the subject of the experiment. And that person is sitting in front of a board with little buttons that he can push that are going to shock, electrically shock, a third person who is, you know, on the other side of a glass in another room, and there's a glass between you. And so the authority figure says, okay, now give him a, you know, six shock. And
right,
the person down there goes, bah! You know, it turns out the guy down there is an actor. You know?
Right.
And the guy who's being studied is the guy pushing the buttons. And what they found out was that 70% of human beings will follow those orders and severely shock and or kill the person. So in other words, they think in their mind, they transfer, well, okay, it's on you. You're going to take responsibility for this, you know, and they go ahead and do it. Well, that is a part of human nature that they have exploited.
Right.
And are exploiting now. So we somehow have to wake up from that response.
Yeah, that's really great. Well, we're going to have to end here. We're starting to break up a little bit on our Skype, but okay. This has been totally fascinating. And the first hour of this thing should make a major impact on everybody, because this was the major trick, and it's going to be, and it's the minor trick compared to the one that they're going to pull off probably this year. So really important discussion, Eric. Do you have any final things you'd like to say? We're going to have your website listed below so that everybody can go there. And do you have anything to say?
Well, I certainly want to thank you, Paul, for letting us, giving me the opportunity to discuss this with you. I think our interviews and discussions are just great.
Me too.
The back and forth is just great. And so I would just say thank you to you. And I would say if people would look at my website, 911nwo.com, at the articles, the three articles that are posted most recently under Operation 911, they do give the information about these 46 plus drills and give a context for that. You know, the military guys, I think your point is excellent. The military guys who are carrying out these orders, you know, most of them, you know, want to serve God and country.
Right.
But many of them wind up very compromised by what they do. This is why people come back with, you know, shell shock from Iraq and Afghanistan. Not only they're wounded, but their minds are shattered, because right. Things are not at all as they were portrayed. They go in there thinking
right.
they're going to, you know, help Uncle Sam, and they wound up serving Halliburton, Cheney's
right.
company, or some, you know, the Wall Street stock market or whatever, and they wind up killing people senselessly, and they have a moral compass, and that, you know, it causes a lot of suffering. So I've heard that the returning veterans are killing themselves at the same rate as they're being killed over there. And
right.
this was close to being true also for the Vietnam vets. So modern war is hell. It's very high-tech mass murder is what it is. You know, people pushing buttons, and they don't really see what's off
right.
behind it. So I think people need to wake up to these realities, and I hope that the information we passed out today will give a lot of people, or at least some people, a reason to prepare for more of these insidious and extremely catastrophic terror drills turning into a live terrorist operation, and realize where the source is.
That's right. Well, thank you very much, Eric, and I'm looking forward to our next discussion. Who knows what the topic will be, but I'm sure we're going to have fun, and I hope people have fun listening to them. Thank you very much, Eric.
Yeah, thanks.